And now hear the reading of the Word of God in the 11th chapter of the Gospel of Mark. It contains an account that unlocks the secret of how to celebrate Palm Sunday. And when they came near Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, he sent out two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and as soon as you have entered it, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it. And if anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it,' and immediately he will send it here." So they went their way and found the colt tied to the door outside on the street, and they loosed it. And some of those who stood there said to them, "What are you doing, loosing the colt?" So they spoke to them just as Jesus had commanded, and they let it go. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their garments on the road, and others cut down leafy branches from trees and spread them on the road. Then those who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Blessed Lord Jesus, guide us as we celebrate your triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and help us to discover what it really means to take part, to give you our needs, and to respond to your need for us. In your holy name, amen. I like little people who do big things to accomplish grand purposes. But I also like big people who do little things to accomplish great things. Each of us is called to be the linchpin in the Lord's strategy in all of the situations of our lives. There is something that he wants us to do or say or be that's absolutely necessary, that if we do not do it, it will not be done, and the world will miss his blessing. The other day I sat in an airplane and looked out the window and saw one of the ground crew preparing a large plane for flight across the ocean. And I noticed how many times he checked the luggage door as if to say, "Oh, I'm never going to let that happen again." You remember the luggage door flew open on a plane over the ocean, and people were sucked out of the aircraft because a little person didn't do a big job as a part of a greater task. Jesus Christ depends on people to serve him and to do his will in the big and the little things of life. And he gives us the password of power as the secret of unlocking his strength and energy to be faithful and obedient in doing what he wants us to do. I like the little people of the Bible. I like those nameless, faithful people who worked in cooperation with Jesus Christ to accomplish his purpose. On Palm Sunday, we realize that the triumphal entry could not have taken place the way it did if it were not for a donkey breeder. How do you like that? Jesus had studied the prophecies of Zechariah, and he found there in Zechariah 9:9 the exact description of his entry into Jerusalem, and it involved riding on the colt of a donkey. Now, reading between the lines with a bit of sanctified imagination, we can imagine that Jesus had reached that donkey breeder there in Bethphage, and that he had been with Jesus on the night before the triumphal entry. And I believe Jesus staged the whole thing. The stunning fact of the triumphal entry was that Jesus was the producer, the scriptwriter, the director, and the key character of the whole drama. It happened when he wanted it to happen, the way he wanted it to happen, and according to his timing. He was no helpless victim. He was the Son of God present in power, atoning for the sins of the whole world. Praise God. And it all took place because he called a donkey breeder to help him, and the donkey breeder responded. And it was all planned out that night before the triumphal entry. And at the end of the conversation, Mary broke open the cruse and anointed Jesus as an expression of love. And that set the tone for it all. And I can imagine that donkey breeder from Bethphage watched it and said, "Ah, that's how you respond to the master." And I wonder if, as they left the meeting, that Jesus didn't take him aside and put his arm around him and say, "I've been watching you. You've been in the crowds. You were there when I raised Lazarus from the dead. I know you're one of my people. Now, as a part of the underground network, I need you to do something for me. Tomorrow, my disciples will come, and they will need that colt that you have. Now, if you will just respond, I'll give you the password. They'll come, and I want you to step out and say, 'What are you doing?' And then they will say, 'The Lord has need of it.' And that will be your password. Untie the colt and let it go. And I'll ride that colt right into Jerusalem." The donkey breeder said, "Really? All right." Well, you can imagine that he had a sleepless night wondering how it was all going to take place. And then the next morning he was out there on the street waiting. And when he saw those disciples coming down the street, he was ready. They began to untie the colt. And he stepped out and said the words that Jesus had told him to say, "What are you doing?" And they said, "The Lord has need of it." "I understand. I'm part of the network." And they took the donkey, and Jesus took the donkey. Cowboys have always said to me that this is one of their favorite passages, because who else could have hands like Jesus to get onto an unbroken colt without it balking? And Jesus just stroked that donkey, and the disciples, responding to their password of power, "The Lord has need of it," took off their cloaks and put them over the donkey. Jesus stroked the donkey and then gently swung into the saddle that they had made, and the donkey remained calm. And in the midst of the shouting and the cheering, carried Jesus into Jerusalem. The magnificent truth of this, dear friends, is that in addition to you needing Jesus, Jesus needs you. Isn't that exciting? There's something to be done that won't get done unless you do it. And the password to power is the Lord has need of it. What an amazing verb form to put with a nominative like that. The Lord has need. The authority, the need. Oh, but it's so in keeping with his whole ministry. Don't you see? He began his ministry and called disciples and said, as I've reached you, we'll reach the world. I'm going to make you fishers of men. It was the topic sentence of his message. And wherever he went, he involved people. A little boy with broken fish and loaves of bread. And he multiplied it and fed the multitudes. But he needed that little boy. And we're sure that he bonded himself to Simon Peter when he asked for his boat. Simon, give me your boat. What do you want my boat for? Give me your boat. I have need of it. And Jesus stepped into it, and they pushed him off from the shore, and he sat down, and with the authority of a rabbi, taught the multitudes. He needed Simon, and he needed his boat. And how did he reach the broken woman by the well? He said, give me a drink. Jesus always does that. He asks us for something so that he can give us what he wants to give. He always gives us impossible things to do that we could not do without him. Don't you see it? How he works. And then when he raised Lazarus out of the tomb, oh, he could have done it all by himself. Can't you see Lazarus come staggering out of that tomb? What was wrong? He was out of the tomb, but he still had grave clothes on. And he said to the people, unbind him. Let him go. Why didn't Jesus do it? Oh, that's the wonder of it. He needs you, and you, and you, for something that no one else can do. Because he's called us to be cooperators with him. Isn't that exciting? And then a humble donkey breeder. His colt. And a triumphal entry. And then during that last week, in preparation for the celebration of the Passover, Jesus said, go through the streets, and you'll see a man standing there with a pitcher in his hand. Tell him that I need a room. And you know who that man was? I believe it was John Mark, because the celebration of the Passover was in Mary's home, and Mary's son was John Mark, the same one who wrote the first gospel. I think Jesus had them all set up. When those disciples come, hold your pitcher up. And when they say, he has need of a room, say, this is the way. Well, that's the wonder of the new life that Jesus has called us to enjoy, working with him, cooperating with him, turning over our resources to him. And what about Joseph of Arimathea? He had a garden, and in the garden was a tomb. And they borrowed the tomb and placed him there after the crucifixion. Well, that's the way he works. Simon from Cyrene helped him carry the cross. Joseph of Arimathea provided the grave. And the disciples became the basis of a new creation, the church. And over again, the password was, the Lord has need of it. And the power would flow as soon as they would respond to what it was that he wanted. Now, what does that mean to you? For the down-to-earth, gutsy things you have to do this next week. It means that in every situation, there's something that the Lord wants done. And our task is simply to say, Does the Lord need it? If he does, I'll do it. It means that we give away ourselves when others need it. It means we give forgiveness when others need to be forgiven. This past week, at the end of dinner with my wife, Mary Jane, I said a couple of things that were probably not well-timed or as kind as they should be. I went to sleep with the memory of that and woke up, and the Lord said, "Go and apologize." I said, "Lord, why should I apologize?" Did you ever ask that question? Why should I apologize? He said, "Do it. I have need of it for your marriage." And so I marched down and said what I had been commanded to say. Happens over and over again in all of our lives. The Lord has a strategy for our families, our marriages, our work, all of life. There are things that he needs to get done, and he's going to do them through you and me. Isn't that wonderful? Yes, the Lord could do it without us at any time. Elizabeth Elliot said, "God gives skills, but he uses men's hands. He could not create an Antonio Stradivari violin without Antonio." Oh, is that true? If he could hang the stars and give a sunrise, couldn't he make a violin? Yes, but he uses Antonio's hands to do it, just as he uses your hands and your feet and your mind, your heart. The Lord has need of you and what you can do. And as a part of that, we become participants in the triumphant Palm Sunday parade. And we praise the living Lord. Oh, there's an inner agenda inside of you. I know there is, because I know there is inside of me something that I need to do in order to be faithful to him. And he comes and he says the password, "The Lord has need of it, and I must respond." This then, they borrowed a place, a bed, to lay his head when Christ the Lord came down. They borrowed an ass on a mountain pass when he rode into town. But the thorns he wore and the cross he bore were his own. And he took it for me to set me free. He borrowed the bread, and with it the people he fed. He borrowed a dish of broken fish, and the people he satisfied. But the crown he wore and the cross he bore were his own. And he took it for me to set me free. He borrowed a ship and preached to the people. He borrowed a nest as a place to rest. Never a home so rude. But the crown he wore and the cross he bore were his own. And he took it for me to set me free. And he borrowed a room on the way to the tomb, the Passover lamb to eat. And he borrowed a cave, and they made it a grave. They borrowed a winding sheet, but the atonement he wore, and the sins he bore belong to me. And he took it from me to set me free.